Hello, everybody, and welcome here to another Kerfuffle Showcase. I am absolutely delighted to have here today, in their resplendent, beautiful blue tops, the gents from Finch. We have Rob and Alexander. How are you both today?
Hello, absolutely fantastic. Thank you, Simon.
Yeah, very well, Simon. Thank you. Good to lovely, be here.
Lovely complementary colours. The pink and the blue go together perfectly. So unlike the missus who always tells me I clash, we've done a really nice job.
Yeah, there you go.
Look at that. Even better. Alexander, you're not allowed to mention that your merch didn't get there. So, as I said,
I was hoping for the cap, Simon.
As I said, don't worry about it. Like British Rail, it does get there in the end. Okay, gents, look, I think what would be really useful just for here is what we like to do is just get to understand, you know, a little bit about the business here. We'll go into some more detail in a couple of minutes. But it'd be really interesting just to understand from your point of view, give us a bit about your background and about the company. Obviously, the company's just launched relatively recently, hasn't it? But already you've got some, we'll come to later, you've got some really exciting first few clients on board. And I think you've got a pretty interesting tale to tell. So would you mind just giving us a bit of background just to kick things off?
Sure, I'll dive in. So I'm Alex. My background professionally is entirely PropTech, I suppose. I left university and cast my job net back in 2008. And I found a little software house that was developing a CRM solution for some national scale estate agents called CML Software. And I started at CML Software as a software technician and developer. And accompanied the software development director, Paul McDonald, in actually building the CML Radar CRM. And between he and I, we actually produced that solution, and that was being used by, as I said, some really great quality London estate agents. And what that experience taught me is how to punch above your weight as a technical person, as somebody who's bringing software to market, and what great enterprise software actually looks like. So that was a really interesting story. And we went on to be acquired by MRI Software. Goodness, that must have been 2018. And that was a natural chapter end to my story there. So MRI have gone on to carry the torch now in the CRM space. And I sat down and looked at, right, what's next for bringing something innovative to the prop tech space? Because at heart, I'm a product builder and somebody who likes delivering pleasing to use software solutions to agency. I didn't want to build another CRM. It's a mammoth undertaking to do something like that. I think you could spend a number of years just catching up with the sort of expected basic level of functionality that people would expect in a CRM.
It's a tough ask, isn't it?
It is a tough ask to get into that market. I think you could spend a great deal of money and a great deal of time just getting the basics before you can focus on the really exciting bits and pieces that people want to do right now. So I actually want to unlock some of the exciting stuff actually earlier than perhaps larger CRM developers can do. And I think we're seeing this in the marketplace now, that through integration programs such as Rebit Foundations, that agents are able to bring in newer functionality more quickly than perhaps their main CRM vendor is moving. So something that passed my desk at CML just before I left was open banking and what that meant to agencies. So straight off the cuff, a few things that would mean to agencies is that a lot of agencies are running traditional bank feeds for their accounts side of what they do, and open banking would be the modern way of getting that data into your accounts package. And another important thing that we picked on, certainly in our experience, was that of data entry, where even something as trivial as keying sort codes and account numbers can result in accidents in data entry or indeed fraud, which is another risk of something that might go wrong when you're collecting bank data. Open banking can help with that because we can take that data securely directly from the bank, know that that data is correct, and also that it belongs to the right person, which is, again, something unique. I mean, we've seen things like the databases of sort codes and account numbers that exist that allow me to tell you that, yes, that is a sort code and account number, but it doesn't tell you who it belongs to.
Yeah.
Anyway, I digress. I'm getting into more than I should. That's a bit of background about me. Over to Rob to speak about himself.
Hi, thanks, Alex. Yeah, so my history, I left college back in 1986, for people who can remember that far back. And I've spent the majority of my time, my working life, in and around property. In the late 80s, I joined a local independent estate agent called Weller Hill and Hubble, and had three or four really enjoyable years there working in the lettings and sales space. Again, for those who can remember that far back, the late 80s, early 90s saw quite a seismic change in the way that agencies were run, as the likes of General Accident and the Prudential bought a lot of those independent agencies to sell their insurance products. And yeah, we really, for a period of time, became direct insurance salesmen, and the selling of property became really secondary. It wasn't something I was really that keen on the way that the agencies changed in that time. So I looked around to do something different. And my first dip into what would now be called prop tech was with a very tiny business called Honeywood Systems, who, not to be mixed up with Honeywell. And they basically built a tiny company over in Southwest London, were building one of the very first property applicant matching products. So I spent a very enjoyable 4 or 5 years there with them. There we were a very small team building and selling and implementing that. I should say at this point that I'm not a coder. That's Alex in the rest times. I stay well away from the code. But that's where I really got into tech. And I moved on from that business to then spend another 12 or 13 years with a much larger software house, who again were basically focused on asset management, but that meant that they had some property management tools, which became my area of expertise. So that was a very enjoyable job working with the military, again working with their property management department. So again, all about maintaining their properties. Whilst it was not specifically residential, it was a similar area of working. Then had a break from tech and did an operations job for my family based in building. My father was a builder, my brother was a builder. We ran a family building business, and I helped with the operations of that business as it grew for 5 or 6 years. And then in 2013, I bumped into Alex eventually, because I started work at CML Software. They had recently released Radar, and the business was expanding quite rapidly off the back of that. And I took an operations role there, really, to sort of formalize what the business was doing in terms of deploying that product. And so it was just really coming up to speed with where Arix was. My journey was very similar there. We worked as part of the management team to build that business, which, as Alex mentioned, was acquired by acquired by MRI. And again, came to a sort of a natural end of my duties there, and had a little break for what I was hoping was going to be about 6 months, but it turned into about 2 weeks, because whilst I was away planning what I was going to do with myself, Alex got in touch, talked to me about at the time, the open banking proposition that he was putting together, and the rest is now glorious history. So,
good stuff. So I think what we need to establish here as well is that you two have been around the property scene for a good long period of time. This isn't about ivory tower techies coming in and creating solutions for problems that don't exist. I mean, I can certainly validate, for those people that don't know, CML was known as the absolute, you know, top end product, wasn't it, on the letting side. I know Repit went down that lettings and accounts route, but we always felt as you as the almost sister company on the other side, didn't we, in terms of had a lot of mutual clients where you handled that very complex property management and account solution.
We did indeed. We were referred to by some as the Rolls Royce of CRM systems, particularly in lettings. I think we had a good recognition around that.
So that's really good. So you bring with it a lot of obviously gravitas there, a lot of experience, and that's really handy to know, because people obviously want to know that before they start you know, investing too much time. Because on the face of it, obviously, a lot of different solutions can be, you know, let's face it, a lot of prop tech isn't overly expensive, but actually the experience can be quite costly if you get a wrong one, can't it? You know, if you don't spend your time getting the right partner, yes, it might not be just too many pounds on the bank account at the end of the day, but you just waste a lot of time. So that's the one thing that, you know, everyone has in precious little regard these days, don't they?
Well, that's absolutely right. I mean, the time to implement a system can be large, both in terms of time and cost, particularly if what you're considering is switching your core CRM and accountancy software. That tends to be a year's project for larger agents to actually embark upon and complete. So absolutely, Simon.
Good stuff. So talk to us then a little bit in further about the detail around it. So what's wrong with the way that data is being collected from customers, landlords, tenants and suppliers today? Where's the issue out there?
So this is about how we need to communicate with our clients as technology evolves around us. I think more and more transactions will be completed on a fully digital basis these days. And therefore, the way that we communicate with our clients needs to evolve alongside that. So a lot of communications will occur by email. So, for example, I might be onboarding a landlord and I might ask that landlord to send over some bank details. And if I do that by email, I'm already opening myself and my client up to the threat of potential fraud. Now, I think agents probably have good internal controls over their own security, but what we are seeing is an increasing risk now that the end client, such as the landlord, has become a security threat to the actual core corporation. And what I mean by that is that the security threat is almost miles away because it happens in the form of data leaks from other larger organizations. Yeah. Such as LinkedIn might leak millions of usernames and passwords, which then get collected by hackers. And then automated scripts in the blink of an eye process all of those, log in to landlord bank accounts, log in to landlord email accounts, and are able to parse through and read all those emails that landlord has sent and received, and then collect from that the fact that you were interacting with a specific agent. And it's from there that I can do something known as spear phishing, where I can impersonate a given landlord and actually call up that agent and say, right, I'm Mr. Joe Bloggs. I transacted with you a week ago. Here you go. You can see that I know the bank account details. I know the property address. I know the rental amounts that we agreed. I've got a copy of a contract, for example, that was signed 2 weeks ago, and I need to change my bank details to something else. So it opens me up to the potential for socially engineered fraud. If we're communicating by email. So it's quite a risky communications channel. So one of the things that we're...
A colleague of mine, Alex, actually had that experience. They actually managed to email the accounts person and mention that they had been authorized by the sales director, and accordingly they thought they were copying him into the actual email. So the accounts person just assumed it and said, I'm authorizing this payment of like £20,000, and it was in and out of the before it'd even known about it, and it just disappeared the minute that they obviously started investigating. There was no trail at all. It's a staggering, what did you call it, spear phishing?
Spear phishing, yeah. I think most people have heard of phishing by now, which is where you might receive an email which is trying to trick you into click a link and give away your details. Spear phishing is where that's done on a more precise basis. Phishing is like a blanket exercise. Yeah. You cast your net into the sea of lots of different people and see who bites to your fraudulent email. Spear phishing is where I've actually got some specific details about a specific business interaction, like a landlord and an agent, and now I'm actually going to specifically focus in on that to see what I can achieve from.
And that must have been what it was, because they knew obviously the two different people that needed to go to within the organization. And that's a staggering and frightening angle here, isn't it? I suppose the problem, and this would be going way back when, this was obviously people's overly paranoid obsession, wasn't it, early on? This is why people didn't like, I remember we used to talk to them about doing our landlord trackers or property trackers, and there was like, oh no, I'm not willing to put that kind of level of detail up on the screen. But with the prevalence of banks actually making this you know, accessible now. It's on the one hand, it's both expected, but it's also now an increasing level at risk of this kind of fraud, isn't it? So you're caught between a rock and a hard place, aren't you, these days?
You can be indeed, yes. So it is how information gets transferred, and can we make it safer for both the consumer and the agent? Mm. And it is also the reduction of error, because I focused straight away on the fraud aspect, but even simple innocent mistakes in terms of how data is collected can result in what we think is millions of pounds of losses to the estate agency industry year on year, simply by miskeying. Oops, you know, I've accidentally keyed the wrong digits into the sort code or the wrong digits into the account number. Funds are then transferred to the wrong bank account, and struggles then begin in terms of the recovery of those monies, which is not always possible.
Just classic human error, basically, as we all know. Precisely. Somebody's not paying attention. And as you said, with the amount of these that are going on a daily business around the industry, those are going to add up, as you said, millions of pounds.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, it could be an accident made as the data has been keyed into a CRM system by a member of staff, or the details were provided to you incorrectly at source, literally your client providing you the wrong details as they gave them to you.
Yeah, okay, that's fascinating. You know, you've already got two absolutely stellar, first of all, 5-star reviews is the key thing, but there you've got Acorn Group, Rob Sargent there, and James Stephanie there from Aaron Estates. So that's a real validation of quality and obviously the innovation that you guys are obviously bringing at this early stage. And I'll just spend a bit of time here. So we hear from Rob, very well known within the industry, a time and cost saving tool that has changed the way we securely collect data forever. Finch is now a key part of Acorn's customer data collection processes and immediately began to prove its value as both a time and cost saving tool. It's quicker and easier for our customers, and more accurate information is fed back to our staff, which avoids administrative headaches. We'll never go back to email again. I mean, that isn't the longest of all reviews, but it's hard to pack any more detail and quality in there, is it really, in terms of giving some great, great feedback. And again, James Stephanie here from Aaron just makes the point, makes data collection as easy and efficient as possible for both us and our customers. Finch workflows are helping us to improve the accuracy of property details and the personal data we collect from our customers. The way Finch can be tailored to meet the specific needs of a business is impressive, and can dovetail into existing processes to create efficiency and improve the customer journey. Ultimately, we know that there will always be T's and C's to prepare, data collect, documents to sign, etc. The admin is the admin, but Finch makes it as easy and efficient as possible for both us and our customers. It shows we are serious about capturing and storing their data securely. Unfortunately, this is, you know, it's going to be, this is going to come into the news in a bad way for somebody, isn't it? You know, when these data leaks and, you know, the fraud does hit, it's a case of, you don't want to be, you know, back at that stage going, you know, coulda, woulda, shoulda, isn't it? This is now the time to start getting your ship in order and letting other people be the news story.
I think Right Move were in the press yesterday, were they, Rob? Was it yesterday?
Yeah, I think, well, Right Move, I think it was Right Move Plus. They're introducing two-factor authentication off the back of some problems that their agents had with their email account, the agent's email accounts being hacked, which meant that there was, some undesirable behavior going on within the Right Move Plus accounts to do with lead generation. So just another example of how email is just not as secure as it needs to be.
Absolutely spot on. And look, we spoke about these really important, and what you've been really kind here today is we've spoken about those workflows that your team can help with. Ordinarily, I think you were saying before when we were talking off camera that, you know, sometimes these can cost, you know, that process can be thousands of pounds. But you've been really, really generous to the first 5 Kerfuffle agents that get involved with you to actually help some of that special onboarding. Could you just give a bit of context there so people can understand what's on the table potentially?
Yeah, so this is basically, you know, the initial consultation that we would have with a business to understand, identify a workflow, and then help them build that workflow. With that, those fees would be waived for for first five kerfuffle introductions that we get. And that could, depending on the workflow that we're doing, that could be anything from maybe 5 to 3K. So it's quite a substantial saving.
Absolutely lovely. Well, I know we certainly love that sort of thing. So encourage anybody to get in contact there to sound you out in it as well. And get it, you need to get this company on your radar, don't you? If what we've been talking about here today develops as it clearly is for the likes of Aaron and Acorn, you'd be absolutely daft not to have something like this on your companies to review process over the coming weeks and months ahead. Gents, it'll be fascinating to have a chat with some of those clients as well in more detail over the coming months, but I think we've really got a good idea today. It sounds very, very exciting. Obviously, it's one of those ones that's delivering an actual solution, which is always preferential. And I can certainly say from my point of view, having known CML very well from the other side of the moat, as it were, what's credible business and an incredibly strong platform you built. So if you can sprinkle a bit of that pixie dust on the new business Finch, then it's going to fly. So, and that wasn't a Finch joke, by the way, but I did tell you I'd avoid all the cheesy ones till the very end. Brilliant, guys, thank you very much. Thank you for spending the time. Do stay in contact with us, and we look forward to your progress with great interest.
Simon, is there one last thing I can sign off on? Because if I don't, Tom, our commercial director, who's not here today, will shoot me for not saying so. Just wanted to encourage people to have a look at the website and have a look at an event that we're running on the 26th of May, the Data Collection Forum, which is basically all about just discussing and hopefully delivering some value to actually educate and provide some education on what are the challenges around secure data collection. I think people will find that very interesting if they have the time to attend.
I certainly will be. So do get Tom to share those. We'll obviously put those up on a blog as well, those event details. Just reminding actually anyone here, we do have events on the platform. So if you ever want to advertise those sorts of things, we're always very, very keen to be seen as the go-to place for events and calendar information. And more importantly, I'd love to see some of the findings from that after you've done it.
Sure, absolutely.
Sounds good.
Thank you very much for that today, and we'll catch up soon.
Thank you, Simon. Very enjoyable.
Until next time.
Bye.
Goodbye.